Body. It's my great pleasure tonight to introduce our opening keynote speaker. That's Dr. Eric Schatt, sitting here at the front corner of the room. Dr. Schatt is the chair of the Department of Genetics and Genomic Science at Mount Sinai Medical School in New York City. He started off at UCLA getting a PhD in biomathematics with Ken Lang, where he got his exposure to statistical genetics, which I think you'll see still permeates everything he's now doing. After a brief stint at Roche, he went to Rosetta Informatics, where he really rose to fame, at least on I think some of our radar screens, looking at the beautiful genomics that Rosetta was doing, and of course Eric was a key driver of a lot of those studies. Eric then, by way of San Francisco, now onto his present position, I believe. And he also is linked to Stephen Friend's SAGE BioNetworks initiative, as are some of us. And you may hear something about that, although I imagine we'll probably hear mostly about Mount Sinai and how things have been going and Eric's much celebrated move as of late. The other thing I like about Eric is he's not just a scientist, he's a family guy and a motorcyclist, and if you read an Esquire article about him from a couple years back, you'll learn lots of things besides the fact that he wears shorts to work. So with that, please welcome Eric Schatt.
All right, well, thanks to Trey and the other organizers for the invitation, and it's great because it's all local, so I like that. So one of the big charters we have at Mount Sinai, one of the reasons I took this big move into New York City, being a great lover of the West Coast, and wanting the New York people though to tolerate the Palo Alto vibe. So we set up the charter at Mount Sinai to be, how do we leverage, you know, the digital universe of information that exists today to impact decision making on a patient as they walk through the door at Mount Sinai? How do we best diagnose that patient and treat that patient based on the digital universe of information, not just what a physician might hold in their head or have access to through an EMR, but how do we leverage all of that information to make those decisions? And of course, the digital universe of information is quite large these days. In 2010, it surpassed a zettabyte of data, which is, you know, of course, 21 zeros in a zettabyte. So that's like 60 billion 30 gigabyte iPhones. It's a lot of information. And so that's why we're, you know, hiring people like a Jeff Hammerbacher, right, who created and led the data team at Facebook, right? Guys who know how to handle that scale of information and the compute infrastructure required and how you interact with that kind of information. And of course, as you all know as well, the life sciences are now becoming a pretty big driver of this big data revolution that we see, and it's driven by these technologies that are accelerating at super Moore's law rates, enabling us to generate lots of information in addition to the clinical data. So think of, you know, imaging data and other modalities of data that are making their way into EMRs. And how do we hook up all that omics information with the EMR data? Again, a big data problem. And ultimately informing on the various dimensions of the individual. And one of the things I've been trying to push over the last several years, and that was the stint at Pacific Biosciences with Chief Scientific Officer in this third generation DNA sequencing company. It was really geared towards how do we present even better snapshots of these systems by evolving the technologies even more. And so one of the technologies I helped develop was this new third generation DNA sequencing instrument, which is looking at single molecules of DNA as they're being synthesized, and that's the sequencing instrument, and you're of course looking at many tens of thousands of those at a time. And the advantage of this type of technology in relation to the current next-gen technologies is the much longer read lengths that can maybe help fill in many of the gaps of this movie of life that we're all trying to observe. And so just to drive the point home, hopefully the animation will play. So here's with the next-gen technologies, right? We're beginning to see scenes and pictures of things that look like something that we think we're gonna understand, right? So in this case, you maybe see a particular scene emerging, But the question is, can we fill in the rest of this scene, the rest of the picture, and if we fill it in with newer technologies, say with the longer reads, is this going to tell us even more information about what we're looking at? And then does it basically change our perception of what we had been looking at, that it becomes something quite different? And so as we know today, you know, there are many gaps in the genome. In fact, we think the genome's been completed, but there's 10% of the genome that we have no idea what's there. The heterochromatin DNA has not been sequenced, and so we have many other regions that are like that that haven't been sequenced. So I embarked on, you know, could these long reads help complete this picture and fill in these gaps and give us a more complete idea of this genome? And would that better enable us to understand how different configurations of the genome may impact on disease? And so this has sort of been the push I've been on over the last several years in trying to bring that into the fold to understand how, you know, a particular orientation of information in a given region may impact disease or protect against disease. So we had shown this in the last several months with one of the first automated finishings of a genome. So this was Nature Biotechnology, where we completed the Haitian cholera outbreak strain genome in an automated fashion using this long read technology. Again, the idea was you're going, you know, many of the aspects of this genome couldn't be completed because of very complex repeat regions that short read technologies couldn't resolve. But we were able to resolve it, and not in a fashion that required lots of manual intervention, but where you could just put the data together, apply the algorithm, and the genome popped out. And then we also showed this with a paper in Nature also last year with the Neil Shaw group at UCSF, where the idea is to get long enough reads to be able to phase all the mutational information that's going on in a tumor, right? So it's a really complex mixture, very heterogeneous, of lots of DNA changes going on, and you have to be able to phase that information on single molecule level to really understand what it's all doing. And that's what we showed in this paper, where we had FLT3, right? Activating mutations in FLT3 are associated with 30% of the AML cases. So everybody thought in the early days that, okay, it's a kinase, so let's design kinase inhibitors, and we're gonna knock out AML for those who are carrying those activating mutations, and all of those trials failed. And so the emerging dogma in the field was, oh, that must have been a passenger lesion. That's not really a driver of the disease, that's a passenger lesion. So let's give up on doing that. But what we were able to show with long reads, by basically covering single molecules that contain the activating mutation, and then in the course of treatment, these other mutations emerged that were in phase with the activating mutation, where the resistance developed. So the ability for that drug to bind to the kinase was affected given these mutations and led to complete resistance. So because we could phase all that mutational information a single molecule at a time, we were about 100-fold increased power to make the kind of detections for resistance versus short reads, where you're not able to phase that information in a complex mixture and you would have never seen this signal. So we decided to do this for the human genome too. So recently sequenced the first human genome using this type of technology, where we went after this Ceph's line that's been one of the most sequenced lines on the planet, this NA12878, and wanted to see, you know, in light of the 454 and Illumina data that exists for this genome, what would happen if we layered in this PacBio long read data, where our mean read length was 4,000 bases, and our 95th percentile was 11,000 bases. And we did this at 10x cover, so we literally had around 500,000 reads that were over 10,000 bases long. So the question was, does that sort of information help fill in the picture of the genome, the gaps that exist, and what can that information tell us? So one of the first things we did with that information was to see whether we could enhance our screening panels that we use for newborns or for carrier testing or for pre-implantation diagnostics. So here's a list of genes that typically get covered in a carrier screen, where you're basically just genotyping these known loci for changes that can cause very bad things to happen in children. So think, you know, cystic fibrosis and other such diseases. But there are a whole list of other genes that aren't so well covered by those panels because they contain complex repeats or expanded repeat regions that aren't easily assayable from those sorts of technologies or short read sequencing technologies. And so think of like the Huntington's disease gene, right, where we know that there are these repeat regions, where the length of those repeat regions define whether you're going to get the disease or not. And so what you're looking at here is the Huntington's disease region with even with the low-level coverage we have around 10 reads or so that completely span on that Huntington's disease region and completely resolve the number of repeats in that region, and that so it could be done as a simple assay. And then the other thing we went after were all the regions in the genome that contain much longer tandem repeat regions. So there are roughly 10,000 regions of the genome that have tandem repeats that are basically 150 bases or longer. Not assayable by next-gen technologies because those reads are too short. So we wanted to see how many of those regions could we completely resolve those counts, something that hasn't been done before in the human genome to sort of classify those different repeat regions. And this is just a plot showing that, so 80 of the 10,000 tandem repeats in the genome, we covered 84%. And so it's pretty amazing with that low-level coverage. And what you're looking at here is the repeat length span that we detected with the PacBio technology versus what was annotated in the HG19 genome. And what you notice right away is this very downward span bias in the HG19 genome versus the genome that we came up with. And the reason for that, of course, is the even with the Sanger sequencing, those reads aren't long enough to span those repeat regions, and so you get this compression in the assemblies because the reads pile up on one another, and yet we were able to resolve that. And the other thing we noted was seeing significant polymorphisms and polymorphic behavior in these regions beyond the beyond this systematic bias, so showing that for the first time that we can accurately categorize these things. These things are likely highly polymorphic in the population and likely going to be playing some role in the biology of the system and disease. So we've now got programs going on to basically type those across the population and see what they're doing. So the DNA, though, is one dimension, right? And I wanted to just highlight the limitations of looking at just one dimension, as we know in these complex systems, if we want to build predictive models. You know, could we do it off of DNA alone? And I like to just highlight, as a human geneticist, the Huntington's disease as an example of both a stunning success and then a question mark as far as what kind of understanding does DNA lead to. And Huntington's, of course, a horrific neurodegenerative disorder. And Woody Guthrie popularized this because he died of this disease in 67. And the human genetics community was able to resolve the identity of the Huntington's disease gene because they were able to type markers across the genome. So this was in the olden days, right, when we didn't have SNP-based genotyping. These were microsatellite type markers at low density spanning the entire genome. And what they could do, though, was see whether these different markers, the different lengths, were co-segregating in families with Huntington's. And what they found was in the Huntington's disease gene, this marker that perfectly co-segregated with the Huntington's disease in these families with Huntington's disease individuals. And from that, we're able to directly identify that Huntington's disease gene. So a pretty stunning success in the old days that drove this entire revolution of why did we do the GWAS and why were we doing all this sequencing. It was because of these early successes that led to this stuff that we all read about every day now. But the problem is, did that lead to an increased understanding of the disease? And so 30 years after the discovery of the Huntington's disease gene, we still don't know what the processes are that are involved in this disease, all of them. We still don't have any cures. We still don't have any effective treatments. So we accumulated some knowledge, but we didn't really achieve understanding. And of course, we see this in other disease areas, right? Alzheimer's is a good one with the APOE E4 allele carrier status being the number one risk factor for AD, discovered 19 years ago today, or not today, but around 19 years ago. And of course, today we still don't have an effective treatment based on that discovery. We still don't even know how APOE leads to this increased susceptibility of Alzheimer's. Nor whether that's even the gene, right? So it's pretty astonishing. Billions of dollars spent, we still haven't achieved understanding. So the aim is we want to try to layer in all these different dimensions of data, not just the DNA dimension, but if we add in other dimensions of data, will it help us complete this movie of life? And so I like to show this animation just to drive that point home, that if we have things like DNA, metabolites, proteins, and RNA, that these things are connected in highly nonlinear ways, right, to form networks that can define biological processes that are going on within the system. And then we, of course, know that these networks don't act in isolation, right? They act in a concert of networks, where this constellation of networks really define the complexity of living systems. And once we understand some of these functional processes that are exhibited by these networks or that are produced by these networks, we can start thinking of diseases and complex phenotypes as networks, not as single genes. And we can start understanding how within a given cell or tissue type, how those networks may be signaling one another, or interacting with one another. Or if we want to get to the true complexity where we're more than just a single cell or tissue type, how these things are communicating across the entire system, how perturbations in one part of the system or affecting one network affect networks in a completely different part of the system. So we're sort of committed to this path in our current positions here at Mount Sinai. And again, the game is how do we integrate all of this information, whether it's DNA, metabolites, RNA, protein interaction, protein-DNA binding, protein small molecule interactions, all of this information, how do we integrate it in ways that lead to predictive network models or just any predictive model that's capable of giving us useful guidance on understanding a disease, how best to diagnose it and treat it. One of the things we do to understand big data of the type I just showed is first establishing correlations, right? So if we're sampling, we're always, in our kind of work, sampling from populations, and in this case we see two traits that we're sampling over the population and we see that these things are correlated. And so the correlation over many variables is very useful, and we see this being used in clinical practice today. So here's a paper we had from Rosetta back in 2001 in Nature and then New England Journal in 2002 that showed beautiful patterns of expression in breast cancer that nearly perfectly predicted prognosis in those individuals. So if you think about the Oncotest DX from Genomic Health, that test is based on this work that was published 13 or so years ago. So those the signatures that are used in the Oncotest DX are represented in this sort of pattern. So having good clinical utility, I think 60% of all breast cancer cases are now screened through that Oncotest DX, and decisions are made on treatment based on the outcome of that test. But the problem with this, of course, is that we don't know what the key drivers are of this particular kind of network versus the responders. What's driving the disease versus what's responding to the disease. And so we like to think about correlation doesn't imply causation, and that just is driven home by this little cartoon where Brian, the fat guy, is told by his doctor that fat guys are correlated with fat dogs, and then he's going to try to solve his weight problem by exercising the dog. And again, it just drives the point home that, that from the correlation information alone, because I've worked with enough biologists now to know that when they see their favorite gene in these beautiful gene expression or RNA sequencing or methylation patterns, I guarantee you they're going to make up a story about how that gene's playing a role, and then they'll go and do a bunch of experiments to prove it. And of course, biologists are smart creatures, so they're not going to just accept it on a whim. They're going to do an experiment. And the kinds of experiments they like to do are these directed perturbation experiments, where in this case, instead of sampling over a population, you're sampling in an individual over time. You have two variables, and you see that they're correlated over time, and you come up with a hypothesis that believe this gene is affecting this trait. And so what you do is you set up an experimental system where you want to perturb this gene and see what the effect is on the trait. So you set up, the experimental system. You do the perturbation on the gene, and you look for the response. And given that sort of succession of events, you'll make a causal inference based on pretty direct data. And so what we decided to do, just given the genetics training, is instead of leveraging these artificial perturbations as our perturbation source to make causal inference, let's leverage what nature gave us, the DNA-based perturbations, where we can take any given DNA locus that's correlating with different traits, and we can stratify the population into different genotype groups. So what this is giving us is the randomization mechanism to actually make the causal inference. So if you think about how you make a causal inference from a clinical trial, right, a randomized, double-blind, placebo-based trial, is you are randomizing people to arms. Well, in this case, we're randomizing people to arms, but we're doing it through the Mendelian segregation. So it's sort of a nice way to just leverage what nature gave us, the natural randomization mechanism to make the causal inference. So we can then observe these patterns where we see changes in DNA correlating with changes in our traits of interest. And based on that pattern, we can actually derive different models to reflect the different scenarios that could be at play in those patterns and fit those mathematically and then simply pick the model that's best supported by the data. So again, it works by saying, if we have DNA variant here, we're looking for changes in DNA that correlate with changes in these two traits. And given that, we know that it's either changes in DNA are causing phenotype 1 to change and in response phenotype 2 or vice versa, or the DNA perturbation is causing these things to change independently. So that's the kind of game we want to play. And of course, we don't want to do it on just two variables with a perturbation event at a time. We want to look at all the perturbations together, all of the variables together, and construct gene networks. So now I'll just show you examples, if I can get this to turn. Now I'll just show some examples of how we've taken that sort of approach, but again, looking at many different dimensions of data, DNA, RNA, metabolites, proteins, protein interaction, protein-DNA binding, to build networks. And I'll just start with some simple successes we had several years ago by leveraging, you know, integrating all of this information, building the kinds of networks I just showed, and then going through the network and identifying what are the genes, the central players in these networks that are causing changes, in this case, in obesity in a given mouse population. So we can use the networks to make those predictions. These are predictions we had actually made, now it's been 7 or 8 years ago, and then had a paper recently in Nature Genetics that showed after doing all the directed validations in vivo for those genes, that all those predictions held up just as we predicted in the networks. And then, of course, we don't want to do that just on pairs of genes causing traits to change, but we want to do it over the entire space of variables to get at these whole gene networks. And they're not just gene networks because they can contain clinical traits, cellular traits, imaging traits, doesn't really matter, sort of agnostic as to the data type. And the way we're doing that is through a Bayesian network reconstruction method, where we're layering in the DNA perturbation sources are kind of mutual information measure to play the causal inference game. And we're layering in things like protein interaction data and protein DNA binding as structure priors, scale-free priors on the network that help us guide how the network's gonna be constructed. And again, the aim you might be thinking of, well, Bayesian networks have been around for a while, but they haven't led to truly predictive models. Why is that? And the reason for that is this symmetry that exists in many of those structures, this Markov equivalence that prevents you from unambiguously directing the edges in those particular structures. But again, what the DNA variation allows us to do is to break that symmetry, right? We can break the symmetry through that perturbation event and resolve the direction of those edges. So here's an example of a network that we constructed from a morbidly obese cohort of individuals. So these were individuals that underwent bariatric surgery, and we collected in 800 individuals omental fat, sub-Q fat, skeletal muscle, liver, and stomach. And what I'm showing you here is all the nodes in the network that are built up from just the omental adipose tissue. So again, all of these nodes in the network are gene expression patterns. Some will be genetic variation events like copy number variation, and the green edges are all directed edges fit by using the DNA variation as a perturbation source. And so how do we then use this information to drive diagnostic decision making or therapeutic decision making in a clinical setting or in a pharmaceutical setting? So what we do, you know, because it looks like this big ball of, you know, a woman in my group who's very artistic, who can make these things look cool, but how do you actually use these in decision making? So the first thing we can do is think about how to inform all the different disease states that we see with this type of network, if the network's meaningful in that context. And so here I'm just gonna show you lots of different signatures that we've generated across different diseases. So things like atherosclerosis, diabetes, inflammatory pain, COPD, asthma, fibrosis, and so on. So we basically take models for all of those diseases. We're generating signatures, molecular signatures for those diseases in the relevant tissue. And then we could take those signatures and project them onto the networks to try to interpret what those signatures might mean and what are the key driver genes for that particular disease versus the responders and how might we target the disease. So the projection of this common signature that was pretty interestingly in common amongst all these different diseases is we project that onto the network, and that's what the pink nodes are. So these pink nodes are a particular subnetwork within this whole gene network that are enriched for genes that we not only see in those different disease signatures, but that we predict are causal for the different diseases of interest. So it's pretty interesting. They're all clustered in this one part of the network, and they cover all of these different disease areas. And so then when we zoom in on that, we can start resolving how, directly how this network is actually structured and what genes are involved and what role those genes might be playing. So again, these are the pink nodes where I've now zoomed in so you can get a higher granular view. And this was a paper we had in Nature a few months ago for inflammatory bowel disease where we were looking at interpreting the GWAS information, the mega GWAS information that's highlighted around like 163 loci. For IBD, and so the question was, could we use this these networks to sort of inform what the heck are these loci doing, and what are the genes, and what processes are they involved in, and so on. So this network turned out to be one of the top networks that was enriched for the IBD genes. So these pink nodes here and peach nodes are now all nodes that harbor variation in the DNA in human populations that associate with IBD at genome-wide significance. So these are all accepted causal loci for IBD, and they're about tenfold enriched for falling in this network compared to the whole network. So this network is organizing a lot of that variation information into this coherent whole. And then we can start understanding, so not only use that for stratifying populations into subtypes based on the configuration of variations that are held in any individual, but we can now use simulation to identify what are the key driver genes in this network that may be relevant for therapeutic targeting or for diagnostic reasons. So these square nodes are nodes in the network that we identify as the key hub nodes, key driver genes in the network. Right, so these are genes that if they're changed in our simulations, they affect the transcriptional state of this network and can have impacts on many of these genes that are causal for IBD. So then that becomes very critical for understanding how you might want to target using a drug. And so just as an example of how we would play that game to get to an actual drug or to prioritize a drug or dismiss a drug, here's the same network that I was just showing you. Now it's in the context of a different disease, type 2 diabetes. Again, this particular network is associated with lots of different diseases. So, you know, asthma, type 2 diabetes, obesity, IBD, RA. And so again, we can go through the network, and we're via simulation, we're performing the biology in silico, right? We're knocking down and overexpressing every single gene, understanding how the transcriptional state or the state of the network changes as a result of those perturbations. And from there, identify as the key drivers those genes that are affecting the state of the network in the biggest way and having the biggest impact on disease. So one of the genes identified from that very random perturbation of all the nodes in the network is PPM1L, a novel phosphatase gene that our model predicted here. You're red if you're downregulated, green if you're up. That if you downregulate PPM1L, you upregulate insulin, downregulate glucose, but you also upregulate fat and downregulate genes that are involved in hypertension, where the prediction was it would move hypertension in the wrong direction, so you would increase cardiovascular risk. So those were the predictions, and then of course those are all statistically inferred, right, from a statistically inferred model, so you want to validate that those predictions are true. So we go into animal models and we knock down that gene in vivo. And here we see a lowering of the glucose as we predicted. We see an increase in the fat mass as we predicted. And we see an increase in the blood pressure as we predicted. So again, the model sort of covering a more holistic view of what's going on through all these diseases, through whole networks of genes, not just single genes and single diseases, but you get the entire picture all at once. The other cool thing about this particular example is PPM1L falls next to PPAR gamma in this network, so we had predicted when we published this in Nature, we gave the exact same prediction for PPAR gamma, that PPAR gamma would, if you target PPAR gamma, you're gonna have the same effect as PPM1L, you're gonna lower glucose, you're gonna increase fat, and you're gonna increase cardiovascular risk. And what do we see with Avandia, the drug rosiglitazone that targets PPAR gamma? What do we know about Avandia? Well, we know people who take it, it definitely lowers the glucose, so that's good, but it also makes them fat. And then we also found out 2 years after we had published this paper that Avandia increases your cardiovascular risk. But in this case, it's people taking the drug and dying of a cardiovascular event versus versus a model that tells you this is what's gonna happen. So now I'll show sort of how we're doing this now all in real time at Mount Sinai to impact decision making in cancer cases where we actually want to use this type of modeling to inform decisions on how patients should be treated in the cancer arena. So we have this personalized cancer therapy program where we're basically taking mainly terminal cases of cancer where individuals are no longer responding to standard of care and are in search for what other solutions might exist for them. And so we have this program where we'll take such individuals, we collect their tumor RNA, DNA, and germline DNA, all the clinical information, and then of course we're sequencing everything and then using all the digital universe of information that exists on that given cancer type or related cancer types, building the predictive models and then interpreting that individual's data in light of these models. So we will detect all the somatic variation events that are occurring in the tumor versus normal. We also do things like CD8 epitope prediction. So here you're looking for proteins that are disrupted that are also immunogenic and specific to the tumor. And in that case, we're driving that towards a novel vaccine development, a therapy that will be designed specifically for that individual disruptions that they have. And of course, using the network integration to organize all that information and then doing chemigenomic screens to say, are the key drivers in the network that are mutated in this individual, are there existing drugs that target those disrupted portions of the network that could be given to the patient? And then do a more functional screen that I'll talk about. And again, the idea isn't just to do try to guide people in current therapies, but it's to design therapies that are very specific to the individual, completely novel, specific therapies to a given individual. So when we think about personalized or precision medicine, you know, I think this is one of the goals, is getting at a therapy that's designed specifically for the individual. So what do we do in those cases? Again, I told you about the vaccine approach, but we can also take key driver genes that are mutated in the network for this particular cancer in this particular individual, and we can make model systems. So one of the guys, we have Ross Kagan, he's had a couple of cool Nature papers showing multifactorial genetic models for cancers, and so we can basically take the genes that are disrupted in an individual, the key driver ones, the main ones, and they can be three or four or five at a time, bang those all into the mouse, into the fly model, and then screen those flies against all existing compounds and all combinations of compounds to see which drugs are gonna affect that tumor. For those tumors that are those drug combinations that we get hits for, we make xenograft model from the patient's tumor, and if that drug combination works, then we can put that combination directly into patient. So that's the sort of strategy that we're thinking about. And just wanted, again, to say how important it is to have the network to inform this information. Is again, what do you get from the network? All the information's organized, and you get the subnetworks that are affected, and then what are the key driver genes of those networks? And what I'm showing you here is across many of the cancers that we're looking at, when we restrict to key driver genes. So here I'm just, these different bars reflect the different types of genes that'll be in a given subnetwork that we've identified, so you'll have genes that aren't in the subnetwork that's affected, you'll have genes that are in the network, what we call local drivers, general driver genes, and global drivers. So the local driver genes are ones that do have a causal effect, but they're more downstream, they're regulated by lots of other things, so they're not the the most upstream key drivers. But for the most upstream key drivers, what we call global drivers, they can be massively enriched. In this case, for this particular, I think this is breast cancer in a chromatin modification subnetwork, it's about sixfold enriched. But we see some cases where this goes up to 100-fold enriched. So you're basically saying, what are the mutations that the tumor is selecting to get it to the next level? And those mutations are occurring in the key driver genes at a much higher rate, sort of validating both the model and the role these genes are playing. So then again, what we do, so here I'll talk about a glioblastoma case that we took on, where we sequence the RNA from the tumor, the DNA, the DNA from the germline, we project that onto the 552 TCGA samples that existed for glioblastoma. We build a predictive model from that. That's the model here. We project the patient's information onto that and then identify the specific subnetworks that are mutated in this individual and what the key drivers of that are. And then we pursue both a novel vaccine development for that individual, as well as doing this chemigenomic screen to identify existing therapies that could be used to target this individual. And for this particular case, here's what the outcome of this was. So we, again, the TCGA data was used to construct the big model, the predictive model, and that network was comprised of around 10,000 nodes that both expression, RNA sequencing, gene expression traits, as well as copy number variation. From there, we identified around 306 causal regulators, global drivers, and 500 functional mutations. But interestingly, we found a subnetwork that was about one-tenth the size of the total network, it's about 1,000 genes. And even though it was one-tenth the size of the total network, it contained half of all the mutations that were being observed in this individual. So half of all the mutations in this particular, for this particular cancer were falling in this one specific subnetwork, which was a highly non-random event. So then we know that this is a pretty important subnetwork. And then we identify the key drivers of that and do the types of screens I just talked about. But one of the other types of screens that we're also doing that provide more functional information is, so this is driven by Joel Dudley, who came to us recently from Stanford and has really been the guy driving how do we repurpose medicines or drugs that you may not know are indicated for a given disease but will have an impact on the targets, and so we want to pick those up as well. So in addition to, so the chemigenomic screen, remember, we'll go after key drivers that are currently targeted by existing therapies. So that's an obvious sort of chemigenomic screen to do. The beauty of the network, though, is you don't need that key driver to be mutated to pick it up in our screen. So if you do a foundation medicine screen, for example, in this type of network, and what are they going to look for? They're going to look for things like KRAS and P10 and PI3 kinase and so on, right? The known guys that if they're mutated, you sort of know what to do. But what our networks will tell us is if P10 isn't mutated, but the entire network around P10, that local context, is mutated and rich for being mutated, we'll flag that as a for any therapies that are targeting that signaling pathway, we'll flag that as a network you want to target. So we don't need the target gene to be mutated to identify it, or the canonical signaling pathway to be mutated to flag it. Anything in the local context of that gene or signaling pathway is enough to flag it. But we also want to take compounds that maybe we don't know whether they're indicated for a given, or we know that they're not indicated for a given form of cancer, but maybe they would be effective in that cancer because they hit certain parts of the network that could have an impact. And so here's how we play that game. You have over here on this side all the disease network, right? The network that's affected, so you have what those genes are. And then over here you have the molecular signatures for all the different compounds. So think of things like connectivity map and the cell encyclopedia and other such efforts that are dosing certain cell lines or organoids with a drug, and then you're looking at the transcriptional readout and you build up that compendia over hundreds or thousands of drugs or drug combinations and different cell lines and so on. So you have all that information, and now you want to use the network and intersect those signatures with the network to say, are there drugs that are pushing the key driver genes in the right direction to affect the particular state of that network in a way that would give us potentially an effective treatment? So this sort of approach had been applied by Joel Dudley and the team at Stanford for this inflammatory bowel disease, where they identified topiramate, right? So topiramate is an anti-seizure drug that nobody had ever thought could have an impact on IBD, but by using this very objective screen of here are networks that are involved in IBD, here are the drugs and the molecular changes they cause, let's do that intersection and see if the genes are being pushed in the right way. And they identified topiramate as a gene that would target IBD. And here you're looking at this IBD state that's induced by a particular chemical that causes the animals to get IBD, and here it is in the treated state, both with the state-of-the-art marketed treatment for IBD versus topiramate, and the topiramate's actually giving as good or better resolution of the IBD than the current market leader. And there's a current paper under review for small lung cell carcinoma, where it's the exact same story, a compound that nobody ever would have imagined would affect small lung cell carcinoma, but is having an impact on small lung cell carcinoma better than any marketed drug, to the point where that's now in clinical testing. So we did that exact same sort of screen for this glioblastoma case, and here is the result of the top-hitting drugs that come out of that. When again, you're looking at key drivers. So what are the subnetworks with key drivers that are disrupted, and are there drugs that are existing that hit those? So here, what's on the y-axis is the ranking of all the drugs that are being screened. And you can see in this case, this irinotecan is the top hitting drug, top of the list for the key driver genes. This is a drug that's currently used in colon cancer, but there's been talk in the glioblastoma community of integrating this drug with current drugs that are coming out of the market as a combination, but something that we pulled out of the data straight away. But look at how important the network was in making that identification. If we would have looked at all genes in the cancer network, we never would have pulled out this drug, right? It would have been in the noise of all the other drugs that are potentially having an impact. But by focusing on just the key drivers, again, why the structure of the network's important, that guy rises all the way to the top. So this is one that for this patient is currently under discussion, whether they give this new drug that's coming onto the market in combination with this drug, given the profile of this particular patient. So that's the sort of strategy that we're taking, that it's on the one hand, it's pretty scary because we're feeling like we're out there on the ledge trying to, you know, impact things that, you know, maybe we don't have any business doing. But, you know, the question is, can we really use this information, this digital universe of information, to make these impacts? And some of the other studies we're carrying out that may be of interest, and this is data we'll broadly share with the research community, is we're, you know, now building up these sorts of data sets on lots of other disease areas where we're trying to go just crazy with the scales of data that we generate. So we have a chronic fatigue syndrome study where we're taking 500 individuals to 250 cases, 250 controls. And I don't know if you know anything about chronic fatigue syndrome, but this is a disease that nobody really knows what the causes are. There are lots of questions about whether it is a disease, and you know, I've met enough of these patients now to know it's definitely real. And these patients undergo you know, horrific inflammatory immune sort of responses that are very debilitating. In response to simple exercise, they'll get post-exercise malaise where they, you know, could be bedridden and almost flu-like symptoms that go on for weeks. And so what we're doing in these patients is we're giving, you know, 250 cases, 250 controls. We're doing exercise stress tests. Before the exercise stress test, we're drawing blood. We're sorting out T cells, B cells, monocytes, dendritic cells, and NK cells, sequencing RNA from all those cells. We're sequencing all of the individual's DNA in the trial. Doing methylation profiling on all those individual cell types. We're doing gut microbiome collection before and after the study, and I've been very impressed with the CFS community and that they've been able to deliver gut microbiome samples on the spot, both before exercise and after exercise. So that's a stool sample, by the way, if you don't know. And Got little signals coming up here. And then post-exercise, we do the same thing, draw blood again for three subsequent days where we're, again, isolating out all the individual cell types, sequencing everything. And in addition to that, we're doing lots of high-dimensional acquisition of data, things like Fitbit monitoring. We're doing actual video collection on these individuals, photographs, and so on to, again, derive features from that kind of information and correlate it with all the molecular information to see whether we can't build models that are elucidating the complexity of this disease and what are the causes of this disease and what could be done to help resolve it. So again, we think in terms of, you know, just the community of individuals that we can profile, that we can assay at that sort of deep level, and how it gives rise to these sort of models that can be predictive. And so our ultimate goal, like where I hope we are in 10 years' time, is with this kind of modeling, where we want to. So if you sort of think about the your life course, right? So you're living your life, and it's over a big number of years. And in your life, you have a health course as well. And so we like to view that health course as a, think of a topographical map, right, where you have many peaks and valleys that may signify different disease states or healthy states that, that you want to be in. And the question is, can we help through the acquisition of all this information guide you through that, that map to keep you on a healthy course and keep you away from disease states? So this is work from Ray Chang that was done actually at UCSD originally, but now he's at Mount Sinai, and we're doing this for disease. So the way to look at this picture is this can be multiple networks that are reflecting normal and disease states. So we're building all of that up from, you know, what I just showed you. And now we want to reflect that information with this type of map, where we take projections of those networks onto this XY plane, where the XY coordinates are giving you different states of the network. So across all of those XY coordinates, you get different states, and then the Z-axis is the energy potential function for being in any one of those states across the different networks that are represented. And so what we want to be able to do, or what we are doing, is determining whether, given the state of your network, which state are you actually in, or which contour are you on, and based in, on which state you're in, the different contours between these states actually define through the modeling what the constellation of genes are that you want to modulate to drive you from one state to the next. So any one of these contours is going to give you, here's the constellation of genes, and not only qualitatively, but quantitatively. So if you think pharmaceutically, you know, here are the four genes, for example, that could be defined by this contour that the model tells you. You knock this gene down threefold, you activate this one tenfold, you knock this gene out, and you pump this one up fivefold. Like, it's actually giving you that quantitative information to tell you how to move from one state to the next. And then we also think about how different environmental stresses, different toxins, so we have all the NIEHS data reflecting all the different toxins and how that moves you into different states, what nodes are being affected in the network, and so on. So the hope is that over time, you know, these maps are going to be good enough to where any point in time we can assay what state you're in, what contour you're on, and then provide you with advice on how you stay on that contour if it's a good one, or how you jump off that contour if it's pushing you into a disease condition or you're already in a disease condition. So that's the ultimate aim, you know, why we're sort of going crazy on the sort of high-end data analytics at Mount Sinai. This is the vision we want to achieve. So that's basically it. I wanted to thank all the emerging group that's focused on this at Mount Sinai. It's been an amazing amount of fun, still doing a lot with PacBio. The Cornell and Cold Spring Harbor joined us on the sequencing of the human genome on the PacBio, which is fun. Still hosting lots of this information off Sage Bio Networks. And of course, we're founding members of the New York Genome Center, like Cold Spring Harbor is, and doing lots with Bob Darnell, including he sponsored our sequencing of the human genome here at Cold Spring Harbor. So with that, I'll stop and ask for questions.
Thanks, Eric. My head is still spinning. It's very impressive. So my first question is, Can you comment a little bit about the relative contribution of the different data types in your network? So, for instance, how much is DNA methylation data sets contributing overall, and is the differential contribution different for different types of diseases?
Yeah, so that's a great point. So we right now sort of systematically take into account all these different dimensions of data, and we do things like reconstruct the networks with and without different types of data and see how the accuracy improves or diminishes, and from that can sort of estimate what contribution a given type of data is providing. And so what I can say is just very generally, the DNA variation and transcriptional data is by far and away the most informative, leads to the most highly accurate. The protein interaction data isn't useful yet in our hands. And a lot of that, I think, is driven by the way that information is assayed, and that if you have really tightly, you know, stable protein complexes, that's well reflected in the transcriptional data, so it really doesn't add anything. If it's not stable protein complexes, it's really noisy. It's not relevant to the condition in which the artificial system, those protein interactions were assayed in, and so on. The metabolite information, we have to stop thinking too about just drawing rot curves for the accuracy of the network and think more about interpretation, because the metabolite data we've seen doesn't really improve the accuracy of the network, but hugely valuable for understanding mechanistically what these edges might mean. So like to the biologist or biochemist, they see these connections and they'll go, oh, this is why, you know, now I understand why you have this statistically inferred connection. The protein DNA binding information is very useful, almost getting up there with the DNA variation information. So we're still like in the, I think, you know, trying to figure a lot of that out, but hopefully that's a little helpful. The methylation data depends on the sets, but we have some just cool stuff coming that'll show in some cases where you see hypermethylation, the methylation data is like amazing, like better than the DNA variation for resolving causal relationships. So it sort of depends on the magnitude of that signal, where in other cases, in cancer, it's the same way. The methylation information, very, very useful. But then in other diseases where it's weaker, we don't, you know, it doesn't have as big an impact.
And so if I may ask another related question. So out of the, say, 25,000 or so protein-coding genes and few thousand non-coding RNA genes in the human genome, how many of the genes are informative in any of the?
Yeah, so I guess what I can say on there is the only thing we have a big degree of confidence in right now in the networks, given the sample sizes that we work with which are typically in the high hundreds and low thousands, are these regulator genes. Like they're just strong enough signal where we can pick it up, and typically in a 10 or 15,000 or 20,000 node network, there'll maybe be 400 or 500 of those that we'll actually really trust and base decision making on. But we typically are seeing a large number of genes. Like we're still having to filter the number of genes we'll pull into a model based on our ability to build it versus its informativeness. So we still, I think, haven't seen that curve plateau out. And of course, as all these new RNAs keep flooding onto the scene, it's still, I think, a very active area. Like if you didn't see the small circular RNA sponging up all the RNA paper in Nature last week or whenever it was, another new dimension of data to think. It was very cool, but we still have a lot to learn.
So very inspiring talk, thank you very much. Has the cancer personalized medicine program been running for long enough in the Mount Sinai so that you can correlate the response to treatments of xenograft models and what happens to the patients?
Yeah, so I didn't want to make it sound like we have this solved. We've run 8 cases so far, glioblastoma, 2 glioblastoma cases, a couple of pancreatic cancer cases, and then head and neck cancer cases. This was more or less to try to learn, how do we turn this crank? How do we get it done in a timely enough fashion to where we can be involved in the decision making? So right when we're doing these, we're doing rapid runs off the HiSeq 2500. So we're generating the sequencing data in a day, and then all the modeling and stuff takes about a day as well. So we're getting from, you know, DNA sample to a report in around 2 days, and that's with whole genome sequencing, by the way. So there's that sort of time component that we wanted to get down. We wanted to try to understand the model. So it's been influential in 2 cases for at least causing the treating oncologists to think about changing the course of treatment, but the decision hasn't formally been made. But we're now just starting a clinical trial on head and neck cancer cases where it's going to be much more systematic, where we're taking in up to 100 head and neck cancer cases. And the beauty of the head and neck cancer cases is the fly model's relevant. So Ross Kagan had a nice paper in Nature on that, where he was building these multi-gene models of head and neck cancer. So it's identifying the key drivers that are disrupted from there, making the fly model, and then doing the screening to come up with novel therapy combinations. The head and neck's also nice because it's not so urgent as like a pancreatic cancer case would be, or glioblastoma. And then we're serially sampling through the course, so that's an easy tumor to assay and to get RNA and so on. So we're, you know, basically have set up that study to get at exactly the point you're trying to make. But definitely didn't want to make it sound like we're like over this hump of having proven everything. I think we're, you know, just now at this stage to be able to show that.
So I had a kind of a more high level question. So after you reconstruct these Bayesian networks, sort of, how do you decide the next step? So in that kind of obesity network, you picked one gene out of, you know, this huge, huge thing. Do you sort of algorithmically figure out the intervention points, or is there sort of a biologist's intuition in terms of poring over these maps to decide the next experiment?
Yeah, and that's a really great point. I like, you know, because I think in this more informatics way, it makes it seem like the biologist isn't important, and that's just completely not true. Like the way we leverage this information is to basically engage the mind of the biologist, right? It's helping feed the biologist the right scale of information that they couldn't possibly keep in their head, because right, even that little thing is based on a ton of information, and it's them going through. So we do a lot of informatics, right? We're identifying what the key drivers are, and those key drivers that aren't predicted, what effect are they gonna have on the state of the disease, and are they gonna have any adverse consequences and so on. So we put all of that together, but it absolutely at the end of the day, as a disease area expert, pouring through that data and forming the very specific hypotheses and how those are gonna be tested and carried forward. So it is a much more elaborate decision making than I probably made it out to be. Yeah.
So my question is also about cancer, and I'm wondering how frequently you see. So you show there are hundreds of key driver genes, and individual patients might have 4 or 5, you are saying. So how many actually sub-networks or networks individual patients do have, and how many key drivers each of those would have that you actually can target those?
Yeah, so in the, for example, in the glioblastoma case, there's on the order of 15 different sub-networks. And they're probably on the order of 20 to 50 different key drivers per subnetwork represented in there. And so how we define those subnetworks is in the TCGA data, if you look at the mutational profiles over all those individuals and then see how those are clustering across the network, and we sort of use those as seeds to identify what the subnetworks are. So we literally see like 15 different subnetworks reflecting different biological processes that are being affected across that population of cases, so it's sort of empirically driven that way by how we do it. And then for a given subnetwork, like I said, there's, you know, anywhere from, you know, 10, 20 to 50 key drivers that then get screened against the drugs. And does that make sense? Is that what you were asking?
Yeah, it's actually answered. So it's related somehow question. So you know this paper that Califano group published about gliomas in 2010. And so do you frequently find those two transcription factors among key drivers?
Yeah, so that's a good question, and I, you know, should have a figure of merit like that in there. So we absolutely see those sorts of things disrupted, but what was most interesting about the case I showed, one of the cases that we did, is this was a relapse, and so it was a recurrent form of glioblastoma, and that patient's mutational profile looked very much unlike all the other 552 samples. First of all, the mutational load was about 10 times higher than the average mutational load of the 500 or the 100 or so samples that have been completely sequenced in glioblastoma, and it carried none of the mutations to sort of the standard genes that you would see within the 100 in the TCGA, and it looked like it was partly a consequence of the tumor defeating, you know, evolving around it, but also DNA damage induced by the treatments that were given as a frontline therapy. So it like one of the initial reactions of the treating oncologist was like, holy crap, you know, these DNA damaging agents that we treat these tumors with may be biting us down the road, like maybe increasing the mutational load and actually helping the tumor evolve beyond where it was when we started the treatment. So we're still, I think, haven't done enough to form any really solid conclusions, but that's sort of roughly where we're at today.
I'm just thinking 10 or 20 years down the line, do you see that our power of data generation and data analysis is such that we're just going to keep collecting huge data sets for every patient? Or are we going to actually have the power to, at some point, figure out which metrics we really need to know?
Yeah, I'm a pretty big believer that there are going to be, you know, systematic rules that emerge that will obviate the need to generate this massive amount of information on every single patient. And we're already sort of starting to see themes of that through all the TCGA data. So so I sort of believe that we'll be way more targeted in the future. So whereas we have this personalized therapy program today, like maybe ultimately we'll do enough cases where the full mutational spectrum is known, and then we're going to be able to do way more targeted. But today we just don't know, so we have to do that.
Thank you for the excellent talk. My question is, how do you know the network you construct, they really reflect the real gene-gene interaction or real regulatory effect? Do you have any method computationally or experimentally validate or verify those, you know, network?
Yeah, absolutely. So first of all, just to make it clear, what we know absolutely is that the network is not 100% right. So we know that when you look at this sort of thing, we know that, you know, especially these nodes on the periphery where you don't have a lot of support through the population you profile for how they're connected, but we do have really high confidence in these key driver genes and the way we, so here, how do we systematically validate those? The regulatory role is that we, through simulation in silico, we're knocking them down and overexpressing them and saying, what's the molecular response that we predict? And then we're based systematically screening. So one of the first hires I made was to a woman who ran high throughput screening assay development at a pharma company. And we now do moderate throughput screening to perturb in cell-based systems that will reflect enough of the state of the network where we're confident it's reflected, and systematically perturb all of those key driver genes, look at the molecular readouts, and then assess how well did we make that prediction. So we do those sorts of things. In this case, we made a direct clinical prediction and then validated that in vivo. So we do that a lot for the cancer cases. And one of the key subnetworks that we did where we had around 330 key driver genes, we're in the process of making antibodies against every single one of those key drivers, and we'll test those in more in vivo-like models compared to the cell-based screening. So we take that pretty seriously. Like, we think that is a hurdle that this network community in general has to get over, of how we can assess the accuracy of these networks. And right now, it's sort of key driver-focused and looking at directed perturbations to do that. But, and I'll also say, like, you'll give the argument, because I've heard it, of doing single genes at a time. That's why this fly, we're really excited about the fly model and other systems that are doing these multifactorial, multi-gene perturbations and seeing whether, you know, how good does our prediction stand up, how well reflected is the network. But I would say it's still really at the early stages. Like, there's a huge opportunity, I think, there for how that gets done.
All right, Mr. Derrick, final applause.
Thanks.